Thank you very much. I've got here, because I attended Jim Ark's talk last night, and they have the list here of the fellows, and I'm just so impressed. I know some of you, but what sort of jumps out is the diversity of sectors that are represented. I'm sure that's something you've been talking about, but you'll hear that theme in my remarks also, and we heard it last night from Jim, and we heard it from the mayor about radical collaboration and so forth. That's, I think, where the future lies, and I'll come back to that theme in a minute as we get started. I'm going to talk for about 45 minutes or so, but I'd really prefer it, and I bet you'd prefer it, if it was more informal and interactive. So all along the way, if you want to jump in and interrupt, ask questions, take a tangent, let's do it, because I know if I have to sit and listen to somebody for 45 minutes, it can get a bit old. With that, let me go ahead and get started. I'm actually going to begin with three propositions. The first is that, and Jim alluded to that, how many of you were at his talk last night, Jim Marks? Okay, so the vast majority of you, because I'm going to be referring to that, and I didn't want to exclude any of you if you missed it. So one of these he brought out during his presentation, which is the fact that our health in the United States is actually worse than in other industrialized countries. A lot of Americans don't know that, so we'll come back to that. The second, which is obviously fundamental to the whole equity conversation, is that there is a lot of diversity in the United States, but unfortunately a maldistribution of opportunity and health among disadvantaged populations. And then I also want to come to this theme about these maps that are sitting in front of you about how much of our health varies at the small geographic level. And this is something that we deal with in a very intimate way in a community like Richmond. So first, the fact that our healthcare is inferior to other countries. It's not that we don't have great hospitals here in Richmond, around the country. We have some of the best doctors, cutting edge research. So there's nothing to be ashamed of there regards the quality of our providers. But the fundamental problem is that our health is shaped by so much more than health care. This is a diagram you're not expected to read. I actually show this in auditoriums when I do medical conferences. And you have tons of doctors and nurses sitting there. And the whole point of it, I don't really expect them to see it either. It's just to tell them this box down here is the health system. to inject a little humility. As Jim mentioned last night, about 10 to 20% of our health is shaped by healthcare. Obviously, everybody needs healthcare, especially if you're sick. But our health is shaped so much more by our socioeconomic circumstances, our environment, both our physical and social environment. We'll talk about that. This is the actual diagram from County Health Rankings, which the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation is fond of showing, which is a more simplified picture than the one I just showed from the World Health Organization of how these different factors influence our health. And it's not something that the average person is aware of. Most people in public, most politicians, most policymakers are in the habit of thinking that health is about healthcare. And that decisions that we make about housing, education, and so forth are unrelated. And it turns out that these are actually much more relevant to our health than anything else. So I had the chance to chair a committee that did an analysis that actually looked at the differences between the United States and other high-income countries. We actually compared ourselves to these other 16 countries, all large established economies, all industrialized nations. And what we found is that our health is actually worse than all of those other countries, despite the fact that we spend more per capita on health care than any other country in the world. On the left is U.S. life expectancy for men. On the right is U.S. life expectancy for women. And you can see we're at the bottom of the list, that other countries have a longer life expectancy. We did the analysis by age groups because we thought, well, maybe it's because we have really bad infant mortality, or maybe it's because we have a lot of violence that affects our young people, or maybe it's because lots of seniors are dying from some chronic disease. And what we found, actually, is that for every age group, we're down at the bottom there in terms of our ranking. From infancy all the way through childhood, adolescence, adulthood, if you make it to age 75, this chart's telling you that you're in good shape, being an American. But otherwise, we actually are at a very big health disadvantage to be living in the United States. This is actually one of the more stunning charts that we produced in our report. This is the probability of surviving to age 50. On the left is men, on the right is women. And just to help you understand the chart, the red dots here are the United States, and the gray dots are the other countries. And it's starting out in 1980 going up to the current time. And what you can see if you go back in time to the 1980s is that the red dot is at the bottom of the range and then falls further down for men. So by the time you get to the current time, we're at the very bottom of the ranking. But look at women. We're coming completely off the chart. In other words, the probability of a woman surviving to age 50 is lowest if it's an American woman. This is not something that the public generally appreciates. So this is a talk about Greater Richmond, so I don't want to be too international here, but I wanted to start out big picture and say we got a big problem in the United States, and it's not unique to Richmond, but we don't think about health in terms of a national average. These statistics I'm showing you are actually national averages, but our health varies a lot by region. So we can take this down to the next geographic level and look at how our health varies by states, and you can see that in places like the South and other parts of the country, our health tends to be worse than it is in other parts of the United States. But even if you take a particular state and drill down even further, you can see more granularity to those health disparities. This is a study we did in California where we looked at differences in life expectancy by census tract. And what you find is that areas of the Central Valley of California and other places have very big health disparities. And the same thing's been done here in Virginia. This is the data, and Mike Royster has a lot to do with the genesis of this project, that looked at health opportunity index, which is a calculation about the factors that shape our health, also modeled at the census tract level. And you can see with this greater granularity that taking a state average is really obscuring a lot of the diversity that's going on in terms of our opportunities for good health. And that's influenced a lot of our work. So, you know, Jim made mention of the life expectancy maps that we've developed. I should say a word about where I'm at here in Richmond. So I direct the Center on Society and Health at Virginia Commonwealth University. And it's a center that's basically about raising awareness about these issues that shape health. We do research, but we do a lot of outreach to policymakers and the public. And part of what we've learned is that we can do all kinds of fancy science and crunch the numbers and everything, but a lot can be accomplished by taking that and putting it in a form that's easy for people to understand. So this Washington, D.C. metro map was developed a few years ago, which was sort of this cute way of using geographic landmarks to help people appreciate that health can vary just between metro stops. And we showed these differences in life expectancy, which got a lot of pickup. But if you look at this and actually look closely at the numbers, you'll see it's only showing a difference of 7 years in life expectancy. I say only. That actually made a lot of news for people that life expectancy varied that much in the nation's capital. But if you pay closer attention, what you'll see is that those numbers are actually, one number is an average for the entire District of Columbia, and then the other numbers are averages for the surrounding counties. So it's a life expectancy for Fairfax County in Virginia, Montgomery County in Maryland, and so forth. Well, a county is actually too big a geographic unit to look at. So we've taken our work down to the sub-county level to look at differences in a more granular way. So if you take a city like Chicago, for example, where we've done analysis of differences in life expectancy of the census tract, you really start getting a sense of neighborhoods and what the South Side looks like and other parts of Chicago that have very big differences in health outcomes. And of course, we've done the same thing in Richmond. We've created the what we call media-friendly map, which is meant to sort of convey the same thing as that DC Metro map did, showing differences in life expectancy with particular geographic landmarks that the Times-Dispatch or others can pick up and make the point to the public, and that's worked very well. And then we have our so-called ugly maps, the scientific maps that actually have the data for every single census tract. And part of what I provided you is not only I don't know if it got distributed, the actual data tables.
That's not in here.
It's okay. So anyway, we're also available to you are data tables that actually tell you the numbers that go into each of these census tracts. So you can look up any particular census tract and see what it is. So before we get too much further, I think we sort of need to revisit this general question of, okay, so why are there such big differences in health? And I apologize if there's some repetition here. You've probably heard this several times in the last 24 hours between Jim Mark's presentation and Abby's and your discussions. But reinforcement doesn't always hurt. So here's the thing. And this is typically the list we go through when reporters ask me, so why is there a 10, 15, 20-year difference in life expectancy? I should make that point before I go much further. Remember I was telling you the DC Metro map only showed a difference of 7 years? We find that if you take a city like Richmond or Chicago or New York, and take that analysis down from county averages down to census tract, you start seeing these bigger differences in life expectancy, 10, 15, 20-year differences in life expectancy. We've seen it in city after city. We've seen it in Richmond. We've seen it in New Orleans, all around the country. Big differences, separated sometimes by just a couple miles or 3 miles where those differences exist. So the reporters will say, well, why is that? Jim had a beautiful way of putting it last night, that often these neighborhoods with a bad life expectancy are literally in the shadow of the big medical center. And he was making the point that healthcare can only do so much and that much more is going on for other reasons. And the main ones we've talked about in his presentation, he talked a lot about it. We'll talk about it some more now. Education and income. The socioeconomic conditions of the people living in those neighborhoods have a lot to do with their poor health. Both economic resources that you need to live a healthy lifestyle and to live in a healthier neighborhood are important to health. And in today's knowledge economy, your ability to have a job where you can earn a decent wage and have the kind of income that allows you to purchase healthy resources depends on getting a good education. So those are major drivers. But other factors matter a lot. Housing stock and the quality and accessibility and affordability of housing is a big health issue. Jim mentioned that last night. Access to healthy foods, both places that sell fresh produce and other foods that are healthy for you, and conversely, living in a neighborhood that doesn't have a lot of fast food restaurants, corner stores, liquor stores, and so forth that are not marketing the healthiest food sources. You need places for physical activity. Jim talked about the typical example of green space and parks for children to play in, but we also think about urban design and how our cities are not really designed for people to walk or cycle to work or to the grocery store very easily. And of course, the safety issues that also enter into the one's interest in doing that. And even in more advantaged parts of our greater Richmond area, you have interstates and exit ramps and a whole variety of different physical features in our urban design that really discourage us from using our feet to get places and instead hopping in the car and driving there. Another factor, which is sort of classic issues of air pollution and water pollution and environmental justice, has to do with how close we live to highways, bus depots, other facilities that are emitting pollutants into the air or into the water. As you know, minority communities and other disadvantaged neighborhoods tend to be the parts of town where those places are located. And so the whole environmental justice movement is about that aspect of equity, and that's and when we think about health and disparities in health, asthma and things like that are important. I see a hand going up.
You said it's okay to go off on tangents.
Please, please.
Okay. So this unhealthy food concept, this kind of bothers me for quite some time. Is the food unhealthy? I think we've become accustomed to saying that grocery stores do not stock healthy food, or there are not enough grocery stores in low-income areas with healthy food. Well, I think that the food, it's not necessarily the food itself, it's the additives and things that we add to the food over the years that science has said will make it better.
Yep.
I think those things have destroyed our body's natural defenses. And so I'm wondering if it's still equitable to say the community does not have access to healthy food. I think you need to change that concept and say that something that says that how do you choose the right food in your environment?
So the tricky thing, that's a great comment, by the way, please interrupt like him. Good role model. The tricky thing about these influences on health is that they're multi-layered. There's no single magic bullet that we can sort of point to that is the reason for poor health. So you're making that point. You're making the point that, well, yeah, it's important to be have a store where you can get fresh produce. But there are other issues as well. You mentioned at the end an important one, which is people need to know how to eat a healthy diet. And traditionally, when I was starting out in my career, the advice was, I'm a physician, so the advice was, well, you got to counsel your patients to eat a healthy diet and give them a handout that lists the healthy foods to eat. Yeah, you need that. And in schools, children need to be taught healthy diets and so forth. That's necessary, but not sufficient, because then you need to have actually a place where you can go get the food. But everything on this slide, not just the food, but all the other bullets on here, if you think about it, are actually determined by larger policy decisions that we as a community or society make. Whether it's the food industry deciding what additives to put into the food, decisions made in the 1950s and 60s to load food with fructose and other high-calorie, dense foods that actually may have a major contributing factor to why we have an obesity epidemic, to decisions made about residential segregation, which I'll be getting to later. Every one of these bullets are shaped by public policies and social values. That if you don't think about those, we're also missing the boat. And solving problems like healthy foods or physical activity require both design changes in our built environment and teaching people about healthy living, and also making decisions at the public policy level to address the root causes for why these things got to be the way they are in the first place. So also here on this list, access to primary care doctors and hospitals. Public transportation was mentioned by Jim a lot. One of you is in the transportation sector. I forget which one of you it is. Okay, so huge. I mean, because we need access to the good doctor. We need access to good jobs. We need access to childcare, and without that kind of infrastructure, the ability to access these health promoting resources is a problem. And then I mentioned residential segregation and other things like social isolation, which are shown to be poor, bad for our health. Meanwhile, back at the hospital, everybody's focused on treating sickness. It's a sickness care system. And the problem we have is that most of our resources are going there. We're now over $3 trillion a year in the United States of what we spend on healthcare. The vast majority of our resources are going into that and not into these other social and environmental factors that shape health. And often, I know on Capitol Hill, but it's true at the state and local level as well, you get the pushback from the politicians who say, well, we don't have the kind of money you're talking about for investing in these social programs. It's just not there. Well, yeah, it's there. As a society, it's there. We spend more on health than any other country in the world. It's how we allocate those resources that's different. Nonetheless, people in the healthcare, yes?
Yes. Probably are going to talk about integration of the healthcare. And I was wondering if any progress here, especially in the resource and public health and primary care services, is any kind of progress that we have seen?
Progress in healthcare providers?
Integration, public health, healthcare services.
Yes. Yes, I think so. Isn't one of you from Bon Secours? Yeah, so you could probably speak to this better than anybody else. I think Bon Secours is making important strides in that direction.
Yeah, I think it was difficult to appreciate it until you get a better view of how other nonprofit systems work. But Bon Secours put a lot of emphasis into dealing with the neighborhood conditions, with grant programs, economic development, tying that into, you know, collaborating with others on healthy food initiatives, a lot of those things to really influence the health of the population on the East End. And then collaborating actually with VCU, because we share so, in the East End, we share so many patients that we realized we couldn't do it alone. So I think how we approach healthcare in the East End has been much broader than just, you know, it's the physician, the visit.
We're not at the point where, you know, the Jim's example last night about United Healthcare investing in housing in Arizona. We're not at that point yet, but Bon Secours is putting capital on the table to actually invest in the community. And at VCU, we have proposals in to CMS, the federal agency that funds Medicare and Medicaid, to test a new system called the No Wrong Door system, which would basically allow the hospitals and emergency departments to systematically screen patients for whether they have social or economic problems and connect them with resources to help. Mike and others are working on the role of community health workers based near in or near public housing to help connect people with services that they need. So we're getting there, but there's room to go. So you know, I think the point we just made is that these types of classic ideas about how to improve health, like addressing the built environment, are part of the solution, but not enough. The movement that has come under the buzzword, I don't know if you've heard this term, health in all policies, became pretty common in the public health field about 10 years ago, I'd say, maybe longer. How many of you know this term? Okay, so most of you don't. Basically, it was an advance when it was first suggested by the health folks, is that rather than just focusing on healthcare, we should encourage policymakers in all of these other sectors to systematically think about health when they're making their decisions. So if you're going to add a new lane on the interstate, and you and your city council or the county supervisors are deciding whether to do that or not to do that, think about, among the other considerations that go into those options, the health implications. In some communities, some states, some local communities, they've gone to the step of actually conducting health impact assessments or commissioning health impact assessments, which are these reports that systematically look at the potential outcomes of different policy options. But in general, the health in all policies notion encourages policymakers in these other sectors, and you could, it says et cetera there because you could keep putting more bullets on here, to think about the health implications of those decisions along with the other factors. But the problem we have with approaching this is that we have siloed a lot of these sectors. So we live in a society, whether it's, you know, the committees in state legislatures that are divided by topic area. So, you know, you have commerce, education, housing, and so forth working in their different stovepipes, are not accustomed to thinking about the implications across sectors. And getting people to realize that there is a relationship between their field and health is a bit of a leap, actually, for many people. So some of our work at our center has been focusing on what we call connecting the dots. We actually have a whole portfolio of initiatives called the Connecting the Dots Initiatives. And it's really about helping people in these different policy sectors appreciate the intersection between these domains. So in our Education and Health Initiative, we've been reaching out to organizations in the education field, National Education Association, teachers, and so forth at the national level, and the Department of Education at the federal level, but also at the state and local level, to raise awareness about some of these interconnections. And they're a big deal. Education is important to health in a huge way. Jim gave some good examples last night of how the relative impact on life expectancy from education competes with cancer in terms of its importance. You can make any number of bar charts like this. You pick any health outcome, really, but certain ones in particular, and you can show that people who don't have a high school diploma are way more likely to have the disease or health problem than people with a more advanced education. This particular chart is looking at how often people rate their health as severe or poor. It could be infant, it could be infant mortality that I was showing you, or asthma, or heart disease, and so forth, and you'd get a similar kind of pattern. And if you look more specifically at the numbers, these are actual statistics on the prevalence of various chronic diseases. You'll again see that people with less than a high school diploma have higher rates. But you look down that list on the left, coronary heart disease, stroke, emphysema, asthma, chronic bronchitis, diabetes, and so forth. If you're a doctor, that's basically what's coming through your door all the time. So healthcare systems look at numbers like this, or ought to be looking at numbers like this, and saying, okay, a less educated population is going to be bringing in a huge disease burden on the healthcare system. Insurers should be thinking about this. But also, as I'll come back to later, employers are thinking about this, because that means much more of their workforce is going to be sicker if they have less of an education. The reason why there's this association between education and health is a little complicated. This is a diagram we developed to try to show the different ways they're related. Education can affect our health. That's the big arrow going to the right, for reasons that you would normally jump to, because if you're more educated, you know how to live a healthy lifestyle, you know what you're supposed to do. Also, you have the better employment, better income, better economic resources to live healthy. So that explains the arrow to the right. There's also an arrow that goes in the other direction, which is if you're sick, if you're a sick child, you've got ADD or you've got asthma or whatever, you're less likely to succeed in school. So poor health can affect your education as well as your economic opportunities that come from it. So that's another reason for those two to be related. But maybe the most important is this green thing at the bottom, the contextual factors. So using the example that Jim used last night about adverse childhood experiences, imagine you're a child age 0 to 3 growing up in a family under stress for whatever reason. So we know from that literature that that kind of toxic stress is bad for the child's health. It affects the brain, it affects the neuroendocrine system, it affects their development. It also increases their risk later on of adopting unhealthy behaviors like smoking, drug abuse, unsafe sex, and so forth. So that early life experience is going to set them on a trajectory for poor health just because of the toxic stress they're exposed to. Oh, and by the way, it also affects their success in school. So you end up with this correlation between poor health and education, but the root cause is actually that early life experience before they ever enter the classroom, which sets up the correlation between them. So it's actually a very complicated thing. We are at a time now where, because of the knowledge economy, people who don't have an education are progressively at a bigger disadvantage than they used to be before. This is showing increases in life expectancy that are generally happening in the United States, where people over time having longer lives. But if you look at less than 12, that means less than 12 years of education, people who have not completed high school, life expectancy is dropping. So today's young people who have not graduated from high school are at a bigger health disadvantage than the prior generations folks. We can make similar bar charts with income. Again, same story, more income, better health. And it shouldn't be a surprise that it's not just limited to physical health, also mental health. People who are living under economic stress, greater anxiety levels, greater stress, greater depression, greater risk of suicide, and on we go. So there's a whole psychological morbidity that goes with it as well. We talked a lot about the social and economic circumstances of individuals. Your education, what kind of diploma is hanging on your wall, your income, how much money is in your wallet. But regardless of your diploma or your wallet, if you're living in a place that's bad for your health, that diploma and wallet aren't going to help you. Your kids are still going to be inhaling that air. You still can't get access to transportation. You still have unhealthy housing. Those environmental conditions become an issue independent of the social and economic circumstances. So let's look at some examples here in Richmond. Just like you can map life expectancy at a very granular level. This is the ugly map I was telling you about, not the pretty one that we showed earlier, not the media-friendly one. You can see the East End and other areas with shaded in darker colors here reflecting the lower life expectancy. But you can make a similar map for poverty and other social determinants as well, and find the same basic pattern. I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. There is a reason that these neighborhoods are the way they are. And this is a whole subject that I don't know how much you've spent on racism in this meeting. No? No racism? Okay. A little bit of racism here.
It might exist, though. We just haven't gotten to it.
Okay. So you're familiar with redlining? So on the map is the redlining map from the 1930s for Richmond. And on the right is the life expectancy map you've seen. This kind of thing is being has been shown for city after city in the United States. This is the Richmond example. I can show you from Baltimore. I can show you from Chicago and so forth. Same story, St. Louis. The neighborhoods that were redlined back then are now the bad neighborhoods. But it was an intentional public policy that created these conditions. And what they've created is neighborhoods that not only were segregated to concentrate minorities and people of certain religious faiths in those neighborhoods, but also that basically put them in a cycle of poverty, a cross-generational cycle of poverty that has exposed multiple generations to very adverse conditions. So now we're living in a time where there's compounded stress. Jim talked a little bit about this now. We're at a point where we understand that this kind of racism gets under the skin in many different ways. It's partly just the cultural memory of what's happened, but there's also biology that's happened. With the stressors that we're talking about actually cause changes in methylation of chromosomes, so that the genetics that get passed on to the next generation, the genes that get passed on to the next generation, are affected by the traumas experienced by the parents. The nature versus nurture thing is sort of going out the window now because we understand that they're interconnected. So it's very important to incorporate those kinds of concerns in thinking about health priorities. We did a report that just came out about a year ago, looking at the whole subject of health equity in Richmond. And I'm sorry that it's too small. This was not, I've shown you some slides where it was intentional not to have people be able to read it, but I really wish you could read this. The first part of the report is looking at the statistics, basically, about differences in health on various measures across Richmond. And this is focusing mostly on the city of Richmond and not the whole region. And you'll see here that there's a discussion of socioeconomic conditions, so I'll read it to you because you can't see it. Education, income, poverty, crime, housing, etc. But then it gets into discussing the health statistics, life expectancy, heart disease, diabetes, low birth weight, infant mortality, and so forth. But the second part of this report is actually the one I'm almost more proud of, which is that we then pivoted and started talking about a set of issues that the community told us were important. We went through quite an exercise of community engagement, establishing a program called Engaging Richmond, which allowed us to develop close relationships with residents in the East End, who we continue to work with 5 years out from when we originally did this. But early on when we got started, we went through a whole exercise of first establishing trusting relationships with them and of what's most important. So some of the topics that came out were mental health, the impact of stigma, trauma, workforce development, services for children, parental involvement, and many others. Actually, there was a total of 40 or so that were ranked and prioritized through that exercise. But we took some of the ones that got ranked the most highly and focused on those in particular. And without addressing those kind of root cause issues, we're not really going to get a handle on our problems. I've talked about Richmond City a lot in these examples, but now I want to sort of widen the lens a little bit and talk a little bit about Greater Richmond and the region. We're seeing a pattern like this I'm about to tell you about across the country. Yes?
Have you been able to look at what happens in terms of zip code when there's gentrification?
Yeah, that's one we need to study. We haven't done it yet, but it's a great idea. Because, I mean, what you would predict is with gentrification, life expectancy improves. But what you want to be able to do is track the population that got displaced and what's happened to them. There's been some research along those lines, but not as much as we need. So what's happening in our region here and in other cities is that the problems that used to be thought of as inner city problems are now suburban problems. Suburban poverty is something that's on the rise in the United States in most of our major cities. And we have it in the Richmond region, and you can get a bit of a sense of it by looking at these maps that got handed out to you. And we hope to do more detailed analyses like the ones I'm about to show you from Northern Virginia, we'd hope to do here in the Richmond region. We got commissioned by the folks up in Northern Virginia to do an analysis that was actually sponsored by the Northern Virginia Health Foundation. So you think, well, why Northern Virginia? They're doing great. Very affluent area, high life expectancy. If you look at the county health rankings, they're always at the top of the list. Why do you need to do it there? Well, because that was actually the very point of the exercise. They wanted to dispel the notion that even in a place like that, they wanted to make the point that even in a place like that, you will find pockets of poverty and need. And if you can show it in a place like that, then you know it exists in other areas. So for example, this is a life expectancy map of Fairfax County, one of the most affluent counties in the country. And you can see big disparities in life expectancy in a place like that. We were able to zoom in on particular census tracts in this affluent, well-off area and identify big disparities in life expectancy. So just for example here, this is census tract 2002.02. If you know the area up there, this is Shirley Highway. So these are two census tracts on either side of Shirley Highway. If you're driving up 95 and going into DC, depending on which way you turn when you get off exit 4, you're going to enter one of these two neighborhoods. Here's the difference in life expectancy between these two census tracts. One life expectancy 84, the other life expectancy 79. So a 5-year difference in life expectancy. But what you can see if you look at some of the bar charts over here and in others that we produce for this report, big difference in median household income. I think I've got this backwards color-wise. These numbers are backwards, but the census tract with the high life expectancy, median income of $186,000. The census tract with the low life expectancy, median income of $44,000, sitting there in the middle of what people generally think of as a affluent area. To look at the difference of the African American population. One, half the population is African American. The other only 4.5%. Difference in foreign-born population. Difference in no education beyond high school. So we can do similar analyses here in the Richmond area that are very important in helping to understand how in our suburbs, in the surrounding suburban counties that surround the city of Richmond, for example, we have areas of concentrated poverty with marginalized populations of color that are experiencing adverse conditions. I want to mention, though, that in addition to the problems that we're seeing with traditionally marginalized populations, we are also seeing a new phenomenon in the United States involving whites, that there is now a problem of rising mortality rates among white Americans, particularly low and middle-aged white Americans of low socioeconomic status. This is a New York Times article that came out about a year ago about a study that was done showing this phenomenon. We're actually right now doing a project at our center using data from California where we're trying to understand this. And it's interesting. I mean, it was a topic that actually got the attention of the Guardian newspaper, which is in the UK. They were tracking this issue at the same time that the presidential campaign was going on. And we're writing about the fact that it seemed, and this is well before we knew the outcome of the election, that it seemed like the same population that epidemiologists and public health people were identifying as having this poor health outcome, rural whites, low educated whites, and so forth, seemed to be the same demographic that was showing up in large numbers to Trump rallies and even Bernie Sanders rallies. The Washington Post actually did a study where they showed that the states voting for Trump, they showed their life expectancy versus those not voting for Trump. Basically, it was pretty predictable based on this epidemiologic evidence we have that these are populations that are experiencing dropping life expectancy, driven a lot by increasing use of drugs, alcohol use, suicides, and so forth, that are affecting their life expectancy. So I want to wrap up by talking about what this means for different stakeholders. So, I mean, part of this is a message that needs to be absorbed by our elected officials, politicians in Washington, politicians in state government here in Richmond, the General Assembly, for example, our local public officials, and other policymakers, even in the private sector. But just to give you one example, if you think about state government and its responsibility for Medicaid and education, in most states, Virginia and other states, Medicaid is one of the biggest budget items. And it's rising at such incredible rates because of the rising cost of health care that it crowds out funding that's available for education. So this particular chart is showing this relationship over time. This is the increased spending on Medicaid. This is decreased spending on education. Helping policymakers who are interested in thinking rationally about these matters to understand that cutting funding on Medicaid at the expense of education is actually shooting ourselves in the foot, because those reductions in education are going to translate into increased healthcare costs and further escalate Medicaid spending. You can follow the same logic in terms of cuts in social services, SNAP funding, off we go. All of those income support programs and other services or safety net programs, cutting those at the expense in order to pay for healthcare is actually a flawed strategy. Going back to that international, oh yes.
Sorry, can I just raise one point on that though?
Yeah.
One thing that the Medicaid spending data sort of masks when you look at it together is that the majority of spending is on a very small portion of the beneficiaries. So it's the older people and people with disabilities.
Yeah.
Where most of the spending is going, even though the majority of the beneficiaries are kids. Their health insurance is relatively cheap.
Right. But if you look at the diseases that are, so you're right, most of healthcare spending in general, not just Medicaid, is concentrated on a small subset of the population with very severe morbidity. But if you look at the diseases that are responsible for that, they are the ones I showed on that previous chart with all those numbers. They are very sensitive to socioeconomic circumstances. So those conditions that are driving that, diabetes and so forth, are actually very sensitive to these public policies that cut these programs, but it's a good point.
I also wonder how it would compare to spending on the criminal justice system.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I'll come back to that in a second, actually. So this is an international study that I want to, I'm not going to get caught up in the international stuff too much here, but I think you'll find it interesting, where they looked at how much countries spend on social services relative to healthcare. So this bar chart is showing the ratio between social spending and health spending. And what you can see here, this is the OECD average. This stubby little bar here is the United States, because you know we're spending so much on healthcare and so little proportionally on social services. But the interesting thing is that the countries above this dotted line are the countries with the highest life expectancy, lowest healthcare costs. They're healthier, they spend less on healthcare, and they invest more in social services. Now, you know, there's some debate about chicken and egg, what's cause and effect here, but the larger sense is, and the same authors that did this study just finished doing it in the United States, and the same thing holds up at the state level. Places that spend more on social services end up having better health. Their kids live longer, and they spend less on healthcare. But that's a government perspective. Let's think about employers. Are any of you employers? A couple of examples here. We're right now doing a project with GE, with the leadership, corporate leadership of GE at their headquarters. Business leaders are starting to understand the argument behind this. They're losing their shirt on healthcare costs. They've tried everything they can to try to reduce payments to doctors and hospitals and so forth to improve the efficiency of their healthcare spending. But they now are understanding the importance of social determinants of health and beginning to think about what should they be investing in to try to improve health outcomes. It helps, they need, investing in education, for example, is something that our local chamber of commerce has identified as important and other business leaders have. Why? Because you need an educated and skilled workforce if you're an employer nowadays. You want to lower healthcare costs. You want more productive workers who have less absenteeism, more presenteeism, and so forth. You're competing in a global marketplace against companies in other countries that have that healthier population. So that means they have healthier workers. That means they're spending less on healthcare and they have a more productive workforce. So the business community has a particular angle on this issue that differs from what government folks would talk about. Jim mentioned last night the growing interest of the Federal Reserve and banks and investors in thinking about investing in health and the idea of innovative funding mechanisms, social impact investments and so forth, that are putting money on the table, recognizing that investments in community development are going to be important to improving health, but also improving economic returns on investment. And so there's a whole, these are publications I'm showing you. The one on the left, published by the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco. Another one on the right, there are others that I could show you, where you're seeing major efforts and major reports coming out from the financial sector about health, about the importance of investing in health. The healthcare system, hospitals, the question that was asked earlier about what healthcare systems are doing about this, are now paying more attention. This is out of Kaiser Permanente, which is doing a lot of work about investing in communities. Studies have shown, like this one, that emergency room use can be cut in half by helping to address unstable housing. So this program in Camden, New Jersey, did a study where they set up a program to help patients in the ER deal with their housing problems, and they ended up reducing their healthcare costs by 50%. This is work we've done here in Richmond, where we did a hotspotting analysis. This is looking at admissions to VCU Health System, where we did geocoding of the patients to find out where they lived. And we found that the super utilizers, as they're called, who are frequently being admitted to the ER and the hospital, live in concentrated areas of the city. And by identifying where those neighborhoods are, healthcare systems can begin to think about, well, what resources should we be putting into those neighborhoods so that the patients are healthier and they're less likely to be those readmissions Jim was talking about. Jim talked a lot, I don't know if you were paying attention, his reference to the good life. I've heard him give this say the same thing several times now, and we ended up writing a paper about it in a medical journal. It's a very powerful idea, and that's why that term health in all policies that I showed you earlier, I think, is a bit narcissistic. It's said by people who are in the health field. But if you take that broader perspective that Jim's talking about, the idea that what we really want is not health, what we really want is to live a good life, and health is something you need in order to do that. You get to this larger notion of, which a lot of different sectors can get into, of how do we improve our well-being as a community or as a family or as a person. And I'm not good with graphics, so this is my little Charlie Brown tree. But the idea here is if you imagine the tree, where the canopy of the tree is overall well-being. Let's say the overall well-being of Greater Richmond. Well, one branch on that tree might be health, but there's also employment. There's also education of our kids. There's also public safety, the environment, and so forth. Clean energy. We could talk about all the different sectors. On the equity conversation, because that's, you know, what you all are focusing on, let's think a little bit about that. I often feel like in each sector, there's people at the very distal end of those tree branches who are all caught up in the inequities. So we in the healthcare field are out at the end of our branch going, we have big differences in health outcomes, and we got to do something here in the hospital, the emergency room, to try to close that gap. And the people in public housing are saying, we've got unfair housing, and there's discrimination, and we're having unfair, the people in the banking sector are saying there's unfair lending policies. There's disparities and inequities in education. So all of those groups are working on, we talked about incarceration, there's also inequities in sentencing, and obviously police misconduct and so forth. We have a tendency in our society when we confront these issues to go to that end of the branch and concentrate on how we're going to put some Band-Aids on that and fix that, which you have to do because that attention is necessary, but not enough attention on root causes. And when each of those sectors look and ask the question, well, what's really at the root of this inequity in housing? What's really at the root of this inequity in education? What's at the root of the inequity in health? We often start talking about the same stuff. There are differences, but there are some common themes. And if we think about how together across sectors we have a shared interest in addressing those root causes, then begin to sort of find an alignment of incentives to work together around it. So one very practical way that this becomes very useful is in making the argument about returns on investment. When our center started working on the connection between education and health, and we were asked, well, what's the ROI of investing in education, and how does the improved health offset the cost of investing in education? Our whole perspective was focused on this 7 o'clock part of the diagram, this linkage here. What's the economic return on investment that comes from lower Medicaid costs and so forth? And there's some favorable numbers there, but it's a narrow-minded perspective when we looked at it that way. And if you step back and realize, well, what are all the benefits of improved education? So some of it is improved health, but it's also better jobs. It's lower crime rates. It's less incarceration. It's stronger economic development, people earning more money, bringing in more tax revenues. If you monetize all of those outcomes from education, then you suddenly have a much more attractive ROI that you can present to policymakers and others in terms of the total impact of investing in those conditions. It also provides an opportunity for people in different sectors to come together and say, yeah, we have an interest in doing something about education, the business community and others. We are living in, I'm almost done by the way, so just the last minute or two. We're living in an era of big data. There's lots of data available nowadays. Where does that fit into what we're talking about here? This is a diagram that one of my colleagues in California developed about all the different kinds of data that exist in health. But if you sort of embrace this idea of how all of our different sectors are so important to improving health and improving equity, and then think about data, you realize we really have a need to pull data together from these different sectors, harness that information so that we can work collectively on improving health. And what you're finding in different cities around the country, and we're trying to do this here in Richmond as well, is people starting to put these dashboards together where you can actually track how we as a community are doing in different domains. This is an example from San Diego where they've set up a set of objectives and are able to actually look at how the community is doing across these different sectors that improve overall well-being. This is my last slide, so we're there. And it's a concert hall, and the point of this is to say that this task of improving health and well-being is a bit of a team sport, sort of like producing a symphony. And you cannot, and Jim said this last night, you cannot succeed. We've tried it for many years, and it has not worked. You cannot succeed if only one sector goes in. So if nothing else is happening, the hospital says, we're going to do something about heart health, and we're going to have a health fair, and we're going to improve heart health in our community, it's not going to be enough. I liken it to an oboe player in this orchestra coming in by himself. The symphony orchestra requires all of those different musicians, each bringing their respective talents into that concert hall. It requires sheet music, it requires a conductor, which is sort of like the backbone organization for a collective impact initiative. And it's only when you have all that together that you get the beautiful music. And the same thing for health and well-being. Our ability to really move the needle and achieve transformative change in improving health and reducing inequities requires each of the stakeholders in a community to each bring their particular talents to the table, their data, their personnel, their access, their contacts, and their constituencies, and together accomplish something transformative that they typically can't do on their own. So I'll stop there. And how much time do we have for talking now?
Till 2:30.
Okay, great. So we got about 20 minutes. Let's talk. Yes?
One of the things that has concerned me is the economic pressures on health systems is here, and I think it's going to continue, and their mergers and acquisitions and closures. We're actually, in a lot of ways, losing a lot of our urban health centers. Outside of academic medical centers, if you really think about it, most of our hospitals are actually located in counties. They're located in the suburban areas. And I think we're going to be challenged with how to connect people who live in urban areas to health providers and health systems more and more as this trend continues. And I think we're going to have to eventually deal with the more suburban and the rural county issues because of the way people are being dispersed. And they're going to have some of the same challenges that historically I think we were seeing in urban areas. The difference is at least there's more of a chance for connectivity mm-hmm. in urban areas because of public transportation. When we get out in the rural areas, people are much more isolated, which makes collaboration more difficult, which makes that connection that people need to have to each other and to services much more difficult. And I see that working in Hanover County, it's much more challenging.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. On many levels. I mean, putting my doctor hat on for a minute, it also affects continuity of care mm-hmm. because it's really hard for people to keep coming back in when they have those kind of distances to go to get access. But also your point about how you have this dispersion of access to resources and the lack of connectivity is a big problem. You know, the solution to that is a whole different talk because really that gets us into a conversation about the crisis facing our healthcare system. Which is now going to take an interesting twist with the new administration, and so we face a situation where it's going to be harder and harder and harder to provide health care to our community, and some Band-Aid solutions are available there too. People talk about innovative ways to bring health care into the neighborhoods rather than relying on the brick and mortar doctor's office appointment or hospital admission to get access to health care or to manage your health, using IT and other tools like that to empower people to take greater control of their health. But those are not going to solve the fundamental problem. So, great point. Yes, ma'am. It's very worrying, but I'm definitely not going to try to get up here and make any predictions about what Donald Trump's going to do. there's no telling what's coming down the pike. I will tell you though that people in many different spheres of the healthcare system are quite anxious about it. Just locally here in town, I mean, we have an academic health center that relies on various payment streams in order to teach medical students and nursing students and to and keep the Nelson Clinic and other entities like that open and serving patients. And there's real questions about whether that flow of revenue is going to continue. how to accommodate that. For our neediest patients and for our needy populations, there is reason for concern as to whether those services are going to be provided. We made, you'll be sensing my bias in all of this, we made progress with the Affordable Care Act, we sort of got to a point where we could start putting behind us the idea of people having to go to the emergency room, uninsured patients having to go to the emergency room to get their health care, and there's a worry that we may be going back to that again if this problem isn't solved. The repeal and replace thing, where they talk about replacing it at some point after they repeal and not having a good solution for the interim in between, is putting a lot of instability and uncertainty into the healthcare system. So insurers are starting to question what they should be doing, and providers and health systems as well, given the lack of certainty about what's going to happen.
So within that chaotic landscape where nobody knows what's going to happen, I'm compelled and agree with what you and Jim and others are saying about the multi-sector approach. And this is a political question for which I apologize, but I don't know the answer because I only know how this works in my sector of higher ed. What's the appetite locally among the healthcare systems to think collectively and collaboratively about this good life concept? Because you are in competition. Right, healthcare is competing with healthcare, and now we're in this chaotic moment, which usually means people double down on their own stuff. And so, as we think about a multi-sector approach, I'm interested because this is the area I have the least amount of knowledge in the healthcare groups locally's appetite to really work together on the social determinants of health and making our region better. So I'm asking you because you're in a unique position to be inside outside at the center of society.
Okay, great question. And I'll answer it sort of in a general way, and then more specifically about our local health systems. So the answer in the general way is I think what's just happened with this election and with the dynamics we just talked about is that a lot of the innovation is going to move from national down to state and local. And most people think the local is where it's at. That some of the most exciting and optimistic and promising ways forward are going to happen in communities that come to grips with these problems. And there's a lot of examples around the country. And I think that's happening here in Richmond, too. I sense there's a palpable sense that we're at a tipping point in Richmond where there is a real energy around cross-sector collaboration. You're right that healthcare systems are competitive animals, and the Richmond's no exception. So the three major health systems, Bon Secours, VCU, HCA, are competitors. But as they are doing in other cities around the country, the more innovative CEOs, and we've just gotten a new crop of innovative CEOs of our health systems here in Richmond, see the business model, the business case, for joining hands around these particular issues. I mean, HCA, I don't know so much about, but I can say with some degree of confidence that there's common ground between VCU Health System and Bon Secours around, like your example, a shared investment in the East End, which is good for both health systems. We've even been talking about sharing data across health systems. So that we can to take that hotspot map that I made with VCU health data and do it with the other health systems data so that we have a more comprehensive picture around that. To give you reason for hope, New York City, Manhattan, has 8 health systems, big health systems, Mount Sinai and all the others. It's probably been 3 or 4 years since this happened where all 8 of them got together and said, you know, we're arch enemies. But we're not going to come, they literally said this, we're not going to leave this room until we come up with a plan for collaborating together. And the article got published in JAMA, the medical journal, and so forth, about the success story that they had there. So, sounds a little corny to say if you can do it there, you can do it anywhere. But there's reason for hope that here in Richmond, with the kind of community that we have, we can do that. Mike?
Yeah, Yeah, thanks for the great presentation, Steve. I guess from the perspective of kind of our role as fellows in this program and to provide recommendations to RMHF, and knowing your experience and the work that you do with a lot of the national foundations that are really at the forefront of health equity work, this type of work that we're talking about, what do you see that those foundations are doing well or could be doing more of that kind of moves in this direction that then we could reflect on in terms of how we think about our role with RMHF?
Well, I think that's a great question. I haven't had a lot of time to ponder it, but I think that the most exciting movements that I've seen with the foundations, and Jim spoke about this last night, is thinking outside the box about partnerships that they wouldn't have thought of before. So he gave the example of how the connection to the Federal Reserve almost happened by accident. He was sort of modest about it, but that kind of notion of where do we have common ground? The exciting collaboration that's emerged between the community development sector and public health is an example of an opportunity for cross-sector collaboration where the, and this is where I think it's exciting, the opportunities are exciting for foundations like Richmond Memorial Health Foundation, is finding those win-wins where these different sectors have a shared interest in a particular policy strategy that will improve health but also improve other things that they care about. So I mentioned, for example, GE. A big company like that is now interested in going into communities, maybe communities where they have a lot of workers, but maybe other communities as well, because they want to be a change agent, and come to the table and help improve community health. But they're asking a question, because they've not done this before, where do we bring value added to the table? So if we think about a city like Richmond, how could a big employer that has a particular interest in improving community health do something different in changing the conversation in Richmond in ways that would move the needle and shift the dynamics that are not getting shifted currently? Is it by just their leadership and being able to use their bully pulpit, so to speak, to try to persuade elected officials and other powerful interest groups in the community to take action seriously? They, for example, are strong advocates of early childhood education and can speak very enthusiastically about the importance of that. Is it by drawing capital into the community, by bringing in businesses and investors to put money on the table to help finance some of the cool ideas that we're developing here in Richmond to improve population health? Are there particular talents and resources that they as a company have, systems engineers, data scientists, others, data platforms that they can put into play that would be helpful to the community? I think foundations that can become incubators for these types of new ways of solving the problem that involve partnerships from sectors that didn't used to play together in the same sandbox can be very powerful, but it's got to be around something that they all benefit from. So it's got to be something, if you take something like early childhood education, that's a great example of a win-win, where we in public health clearly feel that that's important. The education community feels it's important. Anti-poverty programs think it's important. But here you have a case where the business community and employers also see that as something important to them. So if it's good for business and it's good for public health and all the other sectors, then we've got a win-win. There are, of course, examples that don't end up in that intersection of the Venn diagram where it's good for public health or it's good for equity, and the business community could care less about it. And then we don't have that kind of alignment. But for the ones that do, I think there's real opportunity. Yes?
So, continuing that conversation, I know Jim talked about this last night about the oil on the natural gas company in Oklahoma City. that invested back into the city and changed that, that kind of landscape there. How do we have that kind of conversation in a city like Richmond? We have some major companies here, headquartered here, that promote giving back to the community and so forth. How do we get them to really change that paradigm thinking of the way they're doing it now to engage in a true community investment that is about green space, it is about healthy living, not only for their employees, but for the residents around the company. How do we, how might we have some ideas about having that kind of conversation?
Well, I think your question puts us right at the solution, or at least the starting point, is having the conversation. A lot of problems and issues need to get worked out after that. Once the ideas develop and the there's a lot of details, thorny details to work out. But half the journey is just the light bulb going off and realizing we have a shared interest in working on this. So, you know, Jim's example where they said, well, we're in the zip code improving business. That's what we do. And that alignment was, emerged. We've had a couple of meetings at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond here where we've had a conversation about how banks have the CRA requirement, which requires them, because of all the history with the redlining and so forth, that date back to the CRA Act. I forget what it stands for exactly, but they have to invest a certain amount of dollars into community development. And they have to analyze where there are neighborhoods with the greatest need, and the banks have to put money on the table in those areas, but they feel like they could make more rational investments if they thought about it. So they have an interest, the banks have an interest, in doing a better job of targeting that money in ways that are going to do the greatest good. Well, that's a conversation we could have with them, and it's happening in other cities, but we could do it here in Richmond. I could go on with more examples. The point is that if we could have a venue to bring us together, and this is where a foundation can be very helpful as a catalyst for conversation, to put all these people in the same room and identify these opportunities, then I think important things can happen once people realize they have a shared interest and a common goal.
I really think that we need to get away from necessarily having the conversation. As Abby prepared that slide was there about thinking big but act. I think we need to get to a point where how do we really act? We talk about neighborhoods, empowerment, and the things that are happening at the ground level there. How do we really get the jobs back to the people who really need them, and then have that funding or that money is reinvested into the neighborhood to sustain it for a period of time? I think hopefully we can talk about that. And
the great thing is, I mean, I don't want to be Pollyannish about it, but the great thing is we're in a city where, you know, we have leadership that's interested in community wealth building. A serious commitment to equity issues and fighting poverty and so forth. That's not true in every city around the country. I know there's a lot of challenges, those kinds of motivations go so far sometimes, but I still think there's a lot of substrate to work with to move forward.
Thank you. We are enormously grateful for your
time. Well, thank you.